really personable, and usually, you know, you'll even see trainers that are very personable, don't know a lot. They're the ones that are booked the most because they have a good way of interact and communicate with their clients. They find ways to relate to other people, and it's such a crucial part of the job. So I'm looking for that in an interview for sure. I want to make sure that I can make a connection with the person. Can they make a connection with me? Are they fluid with their communication? I want to see passion. I want to see enthusiasm. I don't want someone to just, you know, give me research. Like, that's great. Like, okay, I've read this study on PubMed. No, but like, I want to see your passion for what you do, and I want to see it come out of every pore that you have. And then I want to see some versatility. I want to see that you're able to handle some adversity. If I throw you a crazy question, or I ask you about a crazy time in your life, I want to be able to see that you're going to be able to overcome some of those things, because being a trainer is tough, man. It's not a walk in the park. It's not rainbows and butterflies. Like, you're going to have days where you're going to get the trainer blues, and you're like, oh, what am I doing with my life, right? Mm-hmm. But you got to have some versatility to be able to overcome that. So I want to see some resilience.
Trainer blues, I like that. So give me an example of one of those crazy questions.
Oh, trainer blues. So this usually happens in the summertime. It's perfect because it's just coming up. And usually, you know, the gym can start to slow down a little bit, and you'll often hear, there's just nobody here. Like, there's just nobody here, Chris. Nobody wants to train. Nobody wants to do anything. I'm like, I just look at the check-ins for the day. Like, we had 1,200 people that just checked in the gym. What do you mean nobody's here? Well, but they're all the same people. I'm like, did you go and check every single person and they're the same 1,200 people every single day? Well, no. It's like, okay, so maybe this is a mindset thing, mm-hmm. right? You're bumming out because you missed on the last 10 people that you met with, or somebody told you no on the floor and they were a jerk to you. They don't want to talk to you anymore. And so you take it personally, like trainers do. We're like, oh man, I can't believe they said no. I just want to help them. So you go through the trainer blues, and that's where trainers, sometimes they start looking around, or they quit, or they don't stick with it. Mm-hmm. And what they got to realize is there's going to be points like that. You're gonna be trying to run through the mud on occasion. The best thing you can do is stick with it and go back to the drawing board and figure out, okay, what am I doing wrong? Meet with your coach, meet with your manager. What do I need to do to keep working through the trainer blues?
Mm-hmm. So what is your current title at 24?
So my current title at 24 is regional educator. So that encompasses the education for all of Los Angeles, for the personal trainers, for our sales team. And also I work with leadership development for our general managers and our leadership team in the FM position or the sales manager position throughout Los Angeles, plus also up in Portland and Seattle. So all in all, about 100 clubs. Mm-hmm. And then I help put together the curriculum in addition to facilitating the material.
So I love his whole background, because you started out with your cert as an ISSA.
Yep.
Which is International...
International Sports Science Association, okay. I believe. Tom Platz, first instructor, yeah. Greatest course ever.
So we were just talking about some people that we know have gone through there. There's so many different certs out there. You get your cert, get into the door, start getting your reps in.
Yeah.
And so he worked at other gyms, he did independently, owned gyms. He's been all over the place, and the coolest thing is back in the corporate world. And I love that, just because you hear so many people think that go train at Equinox at 24, whatever, do it for a year, and then go out there and do it your own. And then start your own business, start your own gym. And it's tough, it's expensive as hell. Try managing a gym, and if you've never managed people, it sucks. I do
hard.
A lot. It is.
Yeah.
You know, a trainer comes in and they're upset because something outside of the gym, and I have to get them fired up. It's like, I would rather just train people. I'd rather just have my duties. And so it's really good to hear from your point of view that there's so many things that you can get into as a personal trainer. Get your cert. Get in there, get your reps in. Work with young people, old people, someone who has a labral tear, someone who has rotator cuff stuff. Mm-hmm. Move on, get more reps. So if you had to give someone suggestions, such as someone who just got a cert, ACSM.
Congratulations.
There you go. NASM, AC, and NSC, whatever it may be. What would be your suggestion for the first 5-year period?
You know, it's kind of like what you were saying. You got to get your reps. You're going to get your advanced degree in the field. And so one is training people. You got to get out there and train people and find out a lot about yourself and how you coach and what you're able to do. And you're going to have to learn a lot about how to interact with a lot of different types of people. That's crucial, because you can read a textbook, You can watch a video, you can go to a workshop, but until you get out there and actually train people, you're not gonna know a lot about what you do. And you know, sometimes you hear the armchair experts, right? You gotta get out there and actually do it, because you're gonna get way more expertise getting the reps in training people. Where they say it's 10,000 hours to become an expert. You should train 10,000 hours to be able to find out, you know, what you really need to, what you need to work on, or what you're an expert in, and how you need to keep growing. So it's just getting dirty. You got to get out there and get dirty, right?
Deliberate practice. I get a students will come in and they'll say, I want to be an online coach. Great. Yeah, you may have a lot of followers. That may sound great, sitting down watching Friends, what the hell you guys watch today, and you send out a couple of emails and you're getting paid 10, 15 grand a month. On paper, that looks cool and it seems like it's that easy, but that's not the case. You got to get your reps in. So I agree with you. You got to just train. What would be your one piece of advice for someone who is going through the 24-hour process, and maybe tomorrow they have an interview with a general manager or a fitness manager, GM, FM? What would be dressed the part? What would be maybe some questions they may get, and mindset, maybe some little pointers to help them get to that next stage where they train someone and start getting those reps in?
Sure. Number one is you got to be on time for the interview, and being on time means being early. So plan to arrive 10 to 15 minutes early, you're ready to go, and with that, dress the part. And by that, you know, you shouldn't be in your workout clothes, right? It's great that you got the pump going, let's get serious, right? But I want you to get serious with what you're wearing. So you need to dress in your suit, you need your tie, and be ready to go. You should always look over prepared, because, you know, we're always trying to identify future leaders too, and where do you want to go, and a lot tells us a lot about what you're wearing when you're going in for your interview. The third thing is be prepared. So be prepared with your own questions to ask us too, because you're interviewing us as well to make sure that we're the right fit for you. So have your top five questions written down in advance so you know what you want to ask of us. With that, you know, be in the moment, be focused. Don't have your phone out, don't be texting your girlfriend, you know, or my buddy who I'm gonna work out with later. You need to be focused right here with the person you're with, because I need to see what that interaction is gonna look like. Because if I'm gonna put you in front of a member and they're gonna be paying you $75, $80, $100 an hour, I wanna see how you're interacting with them. You know, are you able to listen? Are you able to ask great questions? Are you able to dig into the conversation? I want to be able to see that in an interview. And then lastly, I want to see your enthusiasm, right? Like, this is an enthusiastic job. You're going to have a lot of passion. And, you know, that's not everything, but it's definitely something. If you're not excited about being there for that interview, and I feel it, I'm definitely not going to throw you out on the floor, because the members are going to be looking for that kind of stuff. You know, are you genuinely excited about what you do? And people watch you all the time, you know, with all five of those things. And if you're not doing them, probably not going to be a good fit both ways.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So you're going to show up, punctual, be on time, be prepared, look the part.
Focus.
And I like the last one. The last one is?
You got to be inspirational.
Inspirational.
You know? You got to have passion. You got to walk the walk, talk the talk. It's got to be coming out of your pores. I want to feel your enthusiasm.
Yeah.
Not that you have to be extroverted, but I want to see that you're excited about what you do.
I always tell people, like, people around you should be like, oh shit, that person looks good. They look confident. They have, you know, if you're sitting down for the interview, waiting to be called in, on your phone, texting, have a smile. If someone shakes your hand, good handshake, not, you know, soft, hey. Or be proud of who you are. Be confident, proud shoulders. They're gonna catch you in a second. I'm sure that it'd be interesting to do like a fun little study. Just by looking people lined up, you could probably be like, probably gonna hire that person, probably gonna hire that person, probably gonna hire that person. Two girls, one guy, whatever it may be. And then they go through the process just by their stature. So
you're in sales, right? Often the first 10 seconds, you know, if you're gonna buy or not.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, that it's very true. First impressions, because people judge style over substance mm-hmm. when they first meet you.
Yep.
So you have to peacock a little bit, right?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, that's I love that. So you said have some questions prepared. What would be a question that would maybe get you to think, or you'd be like, wow, I'm gonna write down this person's name because they just showed me that they've done a little research maybe, or that they're really serious about this position.
You know, I'd ask them, you know, what do you like about working here? why do you work here, how long you've been in the industry, things like that, because I want to hear about their experience and what keeps them there, right? Two is what path do I have for growth? One of the six human needs, if you read any Tony Robbins stuff, he talks about growth. You're always gonna, you're either growing or you're dying. So how am I gonna grow over the next year? How am I gonna grow over the next 3 years? What over the next 5 years? What opportunities do I have available? Because I know that I'm not gonna be in the same spot a year from now. So I wanna be able to find out those kind of things. You know, and then I would say, maybe even asking them, what are you looking for in a trainer? What are you looking for me? What can I do to be the best for your members and over deliver? Because this is why I'm here and this is what I want to do. So if you have those three questions, that would be very impressive to me as an interviewer. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Be careful with asking about pay right at the beginning. Do your research. You could probably figure that out, percentages and all that. Don't ask about part-time jobs. And you guys be cool, like if I worked like Monday, Wednesday, Friday, like 8, maybe like 9 to 12. I don't like hearing that.
Chris, if you want your own business, buddy, you can do that anytime you want. But yeah, you made a great point. You know, compensation is going to be discussed. Like, it's a crucial element of the job. We want to make sure that all of our trainers are able to get the protein, right? You know, get that kind of stuff to be in shape and do the things that they want to do. But we're looking at the quality of the interviewee first, and then we'll definitely get into operational stuff. So it's going to be discussed. But that being said, don't ever take a job if you don't know how you get paid, because I can't tell you how many trainers that I've seen have said, all right, I'm in, and you're like, how do you get paid? I don't know. You got to know those numbers too.
Not to throw any, I'm not going to mention any gym names, but I know some gyms.
Do it.
LA Fit, they'll do half hour sessions and they'll get $9 per session.
Yeah.
So it's like, that's going to be hard to make a living. Yeah, the reps are there. So where's your mindset? Like, I'm getting a lot of reps, but at the same time, I need to at least be able to pay rent, you know, and have the essentials to survive. So
yeah,
you know, be mindful in the beginning, you're not going to be the top tier. So don't come in expecting, and don't see it as 24 charges, $70. I'm getting 2022, screw them. They're taking my business. It's the exact opposite. How expensive was that gym? Look down. That brand on you, that's theirs. Every opportunity you have in their facilities because of them, not because of you. And if you don't believe it, go out there, and I'll tell people, go out today and come back and bring me your own client with no affiliation with the brand on your back. It is hard.
Very hard.
It's very hard, so be thankful. Have a positive mindset, go in there, ask good questions, look the part, show up on time. We'll be some maybe last little pointers to help people get into that interview. Maybe let's take a look at, they do get through the interview.
Yeah.
And now they're gonna come back and maybe take a manager through a workout. So what would be, you have to understand, my goal isn't to kick Nick's ass. I just went through the interview. He loved my suit and everything, asked some good questions. I asked him a question. I said, you know, if you could go back and tell yourself to read one book, what would that one book be and why? And Nick's thinking, that's a great question. I can, I'm gonna bring Chris back. And now I'm gonna take him through a workout. He's gonna tell me he wants bigger arms. I'm not gonna go smoke him on legs and just battle ropes and a Bosu ball and belittle him.
Quadzilla.
What type of programming are you looking for that you guys?
Great question. So first thing I would do is, if I knew I had a workout component to my interview, is I would prepare for that workout. So Chris, I hear you want me to take you through a workout. Before I come in tomorrow, let's go over a little bit about you first. What are your goals? What do you wanna do? What are some injuries that you may have had in the past? What have you been doing up until this point? I need to get a better idea so I can prepare for you, because if I just throw you out on the workout floor, which I could do, and sometimes that's appropriate, right? I want to prepare a little bit in advance so I can give you the best workout possible. And then I think with that, you know, as I'm in that workout, I want to be constantly asking you how you're feeling during the workout. Hey, you know, on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being this is like off the charts, you feel like you're going to die, 1 being you could sit on the couch and eat Cheetos and it would be about the same intensity. Where are we at? You want me to scale that up? You want me to scale that back a little bit? How you feeling? Can you feel it in the areas that you wanted to work today, right? You want to work the guns, right? Can you feel it there? Or are you feeling it somewhere else, right? So those are things that I think any trainer, whether you're in the interview or after, you're going to be asking those types of things throughout and also before. And then at the very end, I want to know, did you like the workout? How did you feel? Did you feel like you came, what you came here for? Those are all crucial things in communication in this session.
Nick is great at great confidence. He looks the part, big biceps. One of the things I think he does really well is that first, and I'm glad he mentioned that, that what if you had to go out there on the spot? I come in with the expectation I'm going to take him through a workout, and he throws me a curveball, and he says, nope, I know you're good at training, but I want you to go talk to that girl over there or that guy over there. What would be a proper approach to take instead of going over there and saying, oh, you're doing this wrong, or oh my God, oh, those are great glutes?
Right.
What would that look like?
Yeah, so people hate when you tell them they're wrong or they suck, right? You know, you ever had that argument with a significant other or someone you know, and they're like, yeah, you're wrong. You're like, you're just like, what? You either get angry or you shrivel up and you want to go away, right? So, you know, it, first of all, if I'm seeing someone working out, they probably got their headphones in, you know, they're probably getting a good workout. First thing I want to do is I want to do something for them. So I might start picking up equipment so they can see that I'm doing something for them and hopefully bring that wall of tension down a little bit. Second thing, I'm not going to try and sell you anything right away. I might say, hey, what are you doing? What are you listening to? I need a new playlist later, and you're crushing your workout right now. What do you listen to? Immediately, you'll see a smile or get a laugh because it's a compliment. Everybody loves being complimented, right? So that brings some of the tension down that this person's not coming over to sell me something. Then I might ask a little bit more about the workout once I find that out. Cool, so now that I got your playlist, like, tell me about your workout. You're crushing over here. What are you doing? What are you working on? And they'll usually go into whatever that program is and what their focus is for the day. And rather than saying if they're doing it wrong, wow, you know, you've got some serious valgus problems on that squat. You got some serious pronation distortion syndrome on that squat. Wrong, don't want to say that. It's going to be something like, hey, well, cool, I see you're working on the squat. First of all, killer exercise for your legs, for your glutes. I love it. You know, tell me where you're feeling it right now. Well, I'm feeling it kind of my knees. All right, cool. Well, I don't necessarily want you to stop squatting because this is a great exercise. What if we do something kind of in between your sets here to help you feel it a little bit more in the glutes where you want to feel it? Would that be something you'd be interested in? Cool. Well, I'm going to grab my little band here, and I'm going to have you do some of these mini band steps in between. I'm going to have you leave that on, and we're going to squat again. And I'm going to ask you how you feel. Can you feel a little bit more in your glutes? Yeah, I can. Awesome. So I don't know what you got planned for the rest of the workout today, but you know, I got a killer leg workout that could complement what you're doing. How about we go through it together? And that's a much different thing than, hey, Chris, we have a sale today and there's 10 sessions, best price point, want to buy?
Yeah.
Right? Or telling them that, wow, you know how bad your squat form is? You really suck. Mm-hmm. Right? I don't want to do that kind of stuff because people are just like, ah.
Yeah.
Can you imagine if you're in a bar and you walked up to like a girl you want to talk to, you're like, wow, you look really fat in that dress. Like, could you imagine how that would go over? Oh, by the way, let me buy you a drink.
Yeah.
It's the same analogy.
It
right?
is. That's great. So make people smile, give them confidence, most importantly, non-threatening.
Yeah.
And the great thing about the confidence that he has, confidence that I have, it comes from education. Continue education. We had a great talk earlier about retention in the industry. People do want to get paid more to a certain level. But then after that, it's, does the company respect me? Am I getting opportunities to learn more? Am I getting opportunities to better myself? Mm-hmm. And so whatever gym you go, whatever route you go, look at your bottom line that you need to survive, and then figure out things that make you happy for your time. Because essentially, that's what I tell students is, you'll go to a lot of gyms and they will try to compensate you with that carrot. But they're kind of taking away the number one resource of life, which is time.
Yeah.
So you get this resentment. And then it's like, you know what, screw 24 Equinox or Crunch. You're taking my clients, that's my money.
I was there. I burned my first two shirts that I had at a campfire. It's true. I was so mad.
Would you say that's kind of right? I mean,
yeah, it's true. It's very true. You know, you get resentful and you know, you look like, oh, that was terrible and woe is me. And, you know, but hey, you got a lot out of that, right?
Yeah.
You learned on someone else's dime. Mm-hmm. They gave you an opportunity to get those reps and fail while still getting paid, right? Mm-hmm. So it's a really good opportunity that most people overlook. You think it's going to be all that better on your own, but sometimes it's not. You got to go through kind of the rite of passage to get to that next step.
Every time I meet with Nick, I always learn something new, and he said something earlier I really appreciated. I was saying, you're probably around a lot of shitty bosses. And he said, those were probably some of my best bosses. And what do you mean by that when you're talking about that?
Because you learn more from bad experiences than you do from great experiences. Mm-hmm. You know, you can remember playing sports. We talk about football all the time, right? And you remember that game where it was like the heartbreaking game. You lost. You made one wrong decision. And you always remember that game, right? Mm-hmm. and it helped you grow. It helped push you to the next level. It's kind of like lifting weights, right? Yeah. You go to failure, or you go to the point where you can't do it anymore, you do it wrong, you get an injury, and what does that do? It teaches you that you need to do it differently. So bad bosses, bad experience teaches you, I don't want to be like that. I want to communicate better. I don't want to lack integrity with my team or my clients. I always want to deliver on what I say I'm going to deliver on. I always want to be transparent with everything I do. Those are the best experiences. And at the time, they suck, right? Yeah. Kind of like that 20 rep squat set. It sucks, but that's where the growth happens.
Yeah. I was reading an article from Tony Gentilcore, and he said the same thing, that he got his heart broken. And from that moment, he told himself he wants to learn more. So he read, you know, top 100 books or whatever. It's like, you know, you will survive, but you got to get out of your comfort zone. Mm-hmm. You got to keep learning. And here's a crazy piece of advice. Learn from us and don't repeat the same shit that we've done.
Yeah, please. Please do not repeat the same shit we've done.
So you've been around for 14 years. We're not bitter or mad. You can laugh about how much faster, because you've got to where you're at now if you know what you know now. But that's the great thing about life.
Right.
And so are there any last little pointers you have for people that are, you know, watching today to help them be successful long term? Confidence, education, make people smile, mm-hmm. continue education, and you know what else?
You know, I think the fact that you're listening to this right now, you're probably one of those people that is already investing yourself, so bravo to you, but just keep getting better, keep learning. You're never gonna know everything. I don't know everything, he doesn't know everything. Even though you may think we might know everything, we don't. And that's the beauty in what we do, is that, you know, if you knew everything, it would be boring, right? Yep. So look at everything as an opportunity for you, and hold on to that mindset. You know, you typically see people that they see some things as obstacles and some they see as opportunities. What kind of person do you want to be? Because what you put up here, you plant that seed and you water it every day. What do you want to grow, mm-hmm. right? You put good stuff in your body, but what you put up here is just as important. So have the right mindset. Do all the things that, you know, Chris was talking about. Invest in yourself, get your education, and look at things as opportunities, and you're gonna have a pretty successful career, but success with fulfillment at the same time.
Happiness.
Yeah.
Last but not least, we gotta do a little one of those handshakes.
Yeah, the broskies.
Great, man, I appreciate that.
That's huge. Didn't screw up this